We are gathered for worship in the presence and in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God graces us with honesty and courage as the baptized followers of Jesus. If we pretend that we are without sin, we are only fooling ourselves and hiding from the truth. But as we confess our sins to the living God and to one another, our faithful and just God will forgive our sins, cleanse us, and free us to walk in newness of life even now. Gracious God,
have mercy on us. We confess, we admit, and we give to you our sins.
We have rejected your ways and your love by our actions, our words, and our thoughts,
in things we have done and in things we have left undone. We are entangled in patterns and systems bigger than ourselves that defy your will,
and we are complicit in their rottenness.
Despite your fierce love that will not let us go, we have turned from you and failed to love you with our whole selves.
Despite your good desire for us to love our neighbors, strangers, and enemies,
we have turned from them as well with hardened hearts.
Despite your call to be stewards of your good creation,
we have failed to care for your world for which we are made.
In the midst of these sins,
we call on you to forgive us, free us, and turn us around. For the sake of Christ Jesus, your Son and our Lord, renew us so that we may witness to your love and walk in your ways in the midst of your world.
Through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and by his authority, we are forgiven. You are forgiven completely, wholly, and freely by the deep mercy of God. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, each of us is set loose to live anew in hope and freedom, even here and now. Amen. We'll sing as our gathering song for the evening. Come, now is the time to worship.
Thank you.
Many people shall come.
Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away, so too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken, and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken, and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Congregation, may be seated. Call it the way of the long car trip. My guess is you have been on one or two in your life before. My guess is many of you have been on the long car trip in different roles and different seats in the car. Sometime, once upon a time when you were younger, you were the one sitting in the back seat with the middle seat of a minivan or station wagon, and my guess is many of you have been in the front seat driving or the passenger side of the long car trip. So even though our destinations have been different, yours and mine, and maybe yours have been recent or further back in the past, I'm still fresh on ours, just a few hours we got back from our trip to the wilds of Ohio, and I can tell you, I'm reminded in the way of a car trip, something about the practice of hope while you are waiting on the car trip. You know how it works, especially if you can put yourself back in being the young kid on the car trip, especially for the young kids on the car trip, on the big holiday trip to Thanksgiving dinner at Grandma's house, you know, over the river and through the woods, or at Christmas time to go see relatives. If you can remember what it was like, my guess is some version of this has been in your experience when you were the kid going on the car trip, or even if yours was a family vacation somewhere else in the summertime, the rules still apply. Number one, once you are belted into that car, all of a sudden it can feel like this is a dog-eat-dog world, and you've got to carve out as much space and stuff for yourself. You know the questions that get asked, right? Are we there yet? When are we going to stop yet? Is it time to eat yet? And you know how easy it is when you are confined to the back seat of the vehicle to start getting real territorial about how much of the back bench you get to claim for yourself, how much of the stuff you get to claim for yourself. And if there's a sibling back there, my goodness, more than one sibling, now we're fighting about who's got more territory, who controls more real estate in the back seat of the car, who is going to get the best places when you arrive, all those games we play, along with he's elbowing me, she hit me, he said something mean, she took my blanket, he took my whatever, as well as debates and arguments over who controls the music station on the radio, or who gets to control the video if you have one of those vehicles with a video player, who's making too much noise, who's kicking the seat, and who denies they are kicking the seat. You've been there before, is my guess. And you also know the difficulty when you are the person in the back seat of the vehicle, of how time seems to warp when you were on the long car trip. And even if maybe at the beginning of the trip a grown-up has told you this car trip is going to be 3 hours, or this car trip is going to be 5 hours, or this car trip is going to be just a half an hour, how once you're in the back seat, it's like you lose all concept of how long it's going to be, so that you've been there forever and also somehow you can't wait to be there at your destination. And somehow it feels like it takes forever and you're waiting and you're waiting and you have no clue until finally, snap, just like that, pull into the driveway of your destination and had no clue it was coming. Time has a way of warping when you're in the back seat of the car, but you don't really know how long it's been or how long it will be, and all you can do is just keep asking, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? Anybody been in a position like that at some point in your life? And you know, especially if you have made a long car trip more than once before in your life, if you know what it's going to be like at Grandma and Grandpa's house over the river, you know what it's going to be like to get to your great Aunt Betty's house for Christmas, and you know when I get there, there's going to be a change of things. We're not going to have to fight anymore. We're not going to be elbowing for room because it's spacious. Man, at Grandma's house, everybody's got a spot at the table. There's enough food for everybody. I don't have to take your fruit snack. snacks. I don't have to claim you stole my Cheetos. I don't have to fuss about where my granola bar is. There's abundant food at Grandma's house. There's plenty of food at Great Aunt Betty's house. And there's room for everybody. And we don't have to fight and fuss and complain because everybody's just so glad we're there. And yet, there is this question while you're waiting in the car. Will you live or act or conduct yourself by the rules of how things will be when you get to your destination? Or will you decide it's a dog-eat-dog world in the backseat of the car and I've got to grab as much of the backseat room for myself as I can? That's really the question. And at some point in each of our lives, when we have been the young and immature people in the backseat, it's almost like we play by two different sets of rules. We can be normal, civil human beings when we get to Grandma and Grandpa's house or Great Aunt Betty's house or wherever. But while we're in the car, it's like all of a sudden we all become Philistines, sort of grabbing and taking and pushing and claiming and shoving and name-calling and kicking and yelling, almost as if we don't really believe when we get there things will be different, almost as if we don't believe the rules of how things work at Grandma's house or at Great Aunt Betty's house or wherever your destination is. It's almost like we don't really believe that's how life is now on the journey. But at some point, you all, became wise enough, mature enough, maybe faithful enough, hopeful enough, that on the car ride, you knew, when we get to Grandma's house, there's plenty of room. And I can start to live now, and in light of that, I don't have to be pushing and shoving. I can be gracious to the people around me, because when we get there, we're still going to have to live with all these people who are in the car with me, and we've got to find a way to get along with each other here, because we're going to have to find to get along with each other when we get to Grandma's house, or Aunt Betty's house, or wherever. At some point, maturity and wisdom, you decide to live now on the car ride in light of how things will be when you get to your destination. And along the way, you trust. I know it's going to seem like a long way. I know it's a long, difficult journey, but we're going to get there. The car is pointed in the right direction. We're going to get there. And when we get there to Grandma's table, when we get there to Great Uncle Joe's table, when we get to our destination, there's abundance and we don't have to shove. And so even now, we can dare to live like it's true, because you know family rules at Grandma's house or at Aunt Betty's house are the same rules that you have as a household in the car. We don't get, we don't need to yell, we don't need to steal, we don't need to name call, we don't need to, because we trust, we will be taken care of. If you know what it's like to have grown through those phases of a long car ride, then maybe you've got a pretty good sense of what it is to be the people of God, and then to zoom out, really big journey we have been on, thousands of years waiting for the arrival of God, making all things new in Christ. And you probably know every piece of that journey, how uncomfortable it is to do the waiting. God, it sure doesn't look like the world is all fixed in. It sure looks like it's a dog-eat-dog world where everybody's got to grab as much as they can, where you got to be grudge-holding and mean and nasty because you got to take what's coming to you and you got to prevent other people from taking what's yours. You got to be mean and tough and difficult. Man, is it easy to believe that's how it works, because that's what the rules of the car trip are. It's also hard to live this life not knowing how much longer we're waiting. For the first generation of Christians, and for Jesus, when he tells his disciples there in Matthew 24 about his coming again, most of the people in the room are thinking, it's going to happen in my lifetime. We just got to get ready, sell your possessions, mortgage the house, because Jesus is coming anytime, so we got to get ready now. And here we've been 2,000 years later. It's not that Jesus was wrong, but like when you're on a long car trip, sense of how time flows, and it can be any moment it could happen. It could be Jesus returning before the end of the sermon or the end of this service, or it could be we live to see our grandchildren and great-grandchildren and teach them to live hopefully in light of Jesus coming. It could be an awful lot longer than that as well, and instead of getting uncomfortable with that or believing we'll never get to our destination, maybe it's all made up, maybe it's all a fairy tale, no, we're people who dare believe, just like you believe. At some point, we're going to get to our destination, Grandma's house, and there's going to be a spread, and we're going to eat, and it's going to be lovely. We're people who dare to believe there is a new creation, and God is gathering us to, and all things will be made new. And maybe this is the moment, then, for us to dare that last step of faithfulness, of maturity, to dare to live now in light of that promised future. So, like when we are the ones on the long car ride, at some point you learn it doesn't pay to steal your brother or your sister's fruit snacks or granola bar or favorite toy or blanket on the car ride. You're going to have to find a way to get along. So when you get to Grandma's house, you're going to have to find find a way to get along with them. Now, maybe you can just abandon all that silly fussing and fighting and stealing and taking and grabbing, and instead use the car ride to be kind and gracious to one another to make that as pleasant as possible as well. If you know how to do that, I'm going to guess we all do, maybe our whole lives can be reoriented. And what will things be like in God's new creation? How will things be different? And what things can I be done with now? Because I trust where we are headed. And even if I don't have a sense of how long it will take to get there, I trust the one who's guiding us there, and that we will get there. So the prophet Isaiah has this amazing, fantastic vision you heard Marge read. And the prophet envisioned, there's coming a day when God makes all things new, when every nation in the world will be gathered to God's house, almost for the big old dinner at Grandma's house, except it's God's temple. And there all peoples are gathered together, and every nation comes to learn the ways of God. And when they come to learn the ways of God, practices like justice and mercy and loving your neighbor and sharing your abundance, when all peoples come and gather, there will be a point when they don't have to start killing each other anymore. There won't be a need to start grabbing your territory or being worried they're going to come take our stuff in the night. And they will be able to beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. And they will not learn war anymore. There will be no need to teach the next generation. You've got to take from somebody else before they take yours. You've got to get them before they get you. And Isaiah dares to imagine, if that's where things are headed, if God is making a new creation where there is abundance, and you know, at God's table, there's enough room for everybody. There will be rolls and butter and macaroni and cheese and whatever else is on your wish list. There will be enough for everybody. You don't have to hate or kill or attack anybody. You don't have to live with that fear and that need for violence all the time. If we dare to trust that's where things are headed, we can be people now in this life, right here and now, who live in light of that promised future, who become people. We no longer have to constantly look at it. What are you going to try and take from me? How can I take from you? I've got to grab as much as I can in this life. We become people who are so grudgeful and we're sort of angry all the time. Instead, we can be people who let go of all those grudges, who can let go of the things that make us so fearful and insecure, because we dare to live in light where all creation is headed. It's difficult, I will confess, because we don't know how long the way will be. Jesus' point in what we heard from the gospel is that sort of, look, life is going to look pretty normal, and just like regular, ordinary life, you'll be doing your ordinary chores when it finally comes, and it'll be this surprising moment. People going through their ordinary chores, people will be plowing in the field, people will be grinding meals together. These are ordinary kinds of activities, and when Jesus' coming happens, it will surprise the heck out of us all and knock our socks off. So in this life, while we wait, without a guess about whether it will happen before the end of this evening or before the end of the next millennium, how we choose to live our lives here, knowing the destination we are being gathered. You can, I suppose, make the car trip on the way to Grandma's house miserable for everybody. I've been there. I know it. My guess is you've been there too. And you know it is possible still to get to Grandma's house and have everybody yelling and fussing and fighting and angry and all this sort of stuff, and they can't wait to get away from each other at Grandma's house, but you're still going to have to find a way for everybody to get along at Grandma's house, because at Grandma's house, everybody is welcome. There is a place for everybody at the table, and nobody gets shunned, no matter what a stinker you were on the way. At some point, you realize it pays not to be a jerk on the car, right? And to make the most of that on your way as well, right where you are, even though there will be even more people gathered when you finally get to your destination. The people who are in the car with you, you make the best attempt you can, being as gracious and decent as you can to them, because you know, you'll be with them on the way, you'll be there at the destination. What if we lived our lives with that confidence in mind? We know, deep in our bones, know God's bringing us to the table in God's house, and there will be enough for everybody, so there is no need any longer for us to be people to keep grabbing and stealing and worrying about who's taking your lunchbox or who's taking your snacks or who's taking your stuff. We will trust there is enough. And in light of that, in light of what we are promised about a new creation, we do not have to learn war anymore. But if we began to be people now who lived in light of that as well, who practiced peace in a small level, making peace with our neighbors and the people we have a hard time getting along with now, forgiving and letting go of grudges, and being people who are a presence of peaceability and peacemaking even now, before we get to Grandma's house, before we get to God's aid, so to speak. taste, receive the bread, drink the cup, but no, here is your assurance. This is where we are headed. And maybe then we are reoriented to trust. Yeah, I will trust. God's promise really is true. There will be a place set for me and for everybody else in the car with me. So write with the people I'm sharing this journey with. How will I live now in light of the assurance? There will be a place for me, a place for them at the table. I don't have to be a Jew on the way. That's what it looks like, I think, to practice hope. It's not just a bunch of empty wishful thinking. It's beginning to live now in light of the promise that we are headed to our destination and God promises to get us there. Before God, when you leave this place, be ready to live like we're on for a long journey. Because we are. But live confident that God promises to get us there and that there will be room for all. Let the congregation to rise as you are able as we sing our song of the day in a far off place.
Right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
congregation is invited to respond here out of here. Gracious God, you are the source of our existence and you are the goal of our lives and our journey. We pray that you would give us such deep confidence in your promises of new creation, where swords can be beaten into plowshares, where all can live in peace, that we would be living witnesses now of your peaceable reign. Enable us in this congregation with our lives, our words, our actions, and our outreach to point toward your mercy and your way of peace in the ways we live toward one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, in this season of giving thanks, we are thankful. We lift up to you our thanks and our gratitude for the blessings of this life, for each breath, for gatherings around family tables, for those who have gathered with us from near and far, for the chance to see family and loved ones. And we also pray for those for whom this season is tinged by grief, by loss, and by loneliness. We pray for comfort for those for whom the holidays are a difficult time and ask that you would open our eyes to reach out with love and compassion to those around us as we make all of our lives a response of gratitude to your goodness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, in this season of waiting and watching, make us to be people of patient love, who are willing to be patient with one another, who are willing to be patient enduring difficult circumstances, who go out of our way and are willing to be inconvenienced for the sake of neighbors and strangers and others in our community, who are willing in our lives to point toward the coming of Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we give to you the names and needs on our hearts this night for those who are troubled or sick in body, in mind, and in spirit. We lift up to you Sean, Judy, Jeff, the Benedict and Simmons family, Bill, Oakland, Marilyn's family, Ted, family of Lucy Milana, who we celebrate with Carla on her 20th birthday. We lift up to you as well those whose names and needs we do not know but are never forgotten or unknown to you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we trust your promise that you are gathering us all to your new creation where all things are made new. And so we give you thanks for your promise that those who have gone before us are at rest in you and that you promise us reunion with them at your great family dinner table where your sinful feast forever in the resurrection joy that has no end. Give us confidence in the meantime on this life's journey. Moving forward as you lead us, knowing our future is secure. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we give all these prayers, names, and needs, along with all those whose names and needs we do not know, trusting in your deep mercy through your Son who came into our midst, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
You're invited to share a sign of Christ's peace. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let's pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Here in our midst, the living Christ has come. The living God has embraced us in love, and the living Spirit has refreshed us to be people of hope and messengers of good news.
We are now sent into the midst of the world, still aching for that good news. And so we call on God to bless us.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you.